everybody. Thanks for joining us to our webinar about the 2020 new maize crop. I am Élise Grolière. I'm part of the marketing team at Lima Green Ingredients. And today's presentation will be hosted by Claude Gagnol, our integrated chains and purchasing director at Lima Green Ingredients. First, let me just remind you some quick information about our webinar. So all the attendees are on mute. If you have any question, just ask them on the chat on the right of your screen, and we will answer to the questions at the end of the webinar. And if we don't have time to do it today, we will answer you personally after this webinar. So the presentation will also be sent after the webinar. Just a quick information about today's agenda. Claude is going to present and explain to us the market fundamentals of these new crops of this year and the worldwide and French and European maize market review. And in the end, like I said, question and answers session. Before letting Claude starting his presentation, let me just introduce him. So Claude is our integrated chains and purchasing director at Lima Green Ingredients, but he's also the USM president. So the USM is a French maize milling industry. He's also Euromaïsier president. So it's the European maize milling industry organization, and is our wheat and maize sourcing specialist here at Lima Green Ingredients. So, Claude, up to you now.
Thank you, Elise. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to share this market overviews. As you know, this year it's a little bit complicated to follow the market, and I hope that through my presentation I can bring you to you some, I would say, valuable information to take your decision and to source the material at the right place. Okay, let's have a look first about the market fundamentals, so the new crop 2021. So the wheat is reaching more or less 728 million tons. This is what we expect from this crop, while the maize is reaching some ice at 1 billion 166 million tons. It is a record. So on the mapping, you can see where the two crops are located. So you can see that the corn crop is located on the world scale level in North Hemisphere and South Hemisphere. So now we are harvesting the North Hemisphere crop. And I would say from Jan till March or April, we will be harvesting the crop in the South Hemisphere. So meaning that we will know the final crop when everything is stored. So that means we have to wait the South Hemisphere crop to have a clear picture of the situation. So until that time, we can expect some change in terms of weather conditions, especially in the South Hemisphere, for instance, which could impact the final results of the crop. So, and I do not, I do not think it will make things stable, because this year we are living a very unstable market situation, and I'm very confident that the future will be moving according to the climate trend until the new crop in South Hemisphere to come up. So let's talk about the market fundamentals, and we have the structural elements which are concerning the acreage of the wheat and the maize. Wheat and maize are very connected each other because they deliver energy for food, whatever is the destination, food grade or feed grade. And we can replace for the animal feeding the wheat by the corn and the corn by the wheat. So, of course, the acreage and the yield will give the volume for each area. Then there is an important ratio, which is the stock over the consumption. And this ratio is moving year for, 2 years, and we will see that this year it's a little bit sensitive issue. Then the animal feed consumption is very important, because for the corn, it is the most important user of corn. It's more or less 80-85% of the world crop, not the world crop because the states are using the corn for ethanol, but it is the largest user of corn for animal feeding in the world. So you have as well the impact of the soybean production, because the American farmer and the Brazilian one, they can switch from one crop to the other one according to the profitability they can expect from one crop. If they expect a good profitability from soybean, so they will plant soybean instead of corn. And of course, as the wheat and the corn are very much linked each other, the wheat price is impacting on the wheat corn, and the demand for the corn price, and the demand for corn can move according to the price of the wheat. So concerning the volatile elements, of course, there is a weather market, and every year it is the same story. On a day-to-day basis, the market is moving according to the weather forecast. And at the time, it is becoming critical when the stock and the crop are not so good. So, for instance, this year it is important to notice that we are experiencing once again, some drought in Europe. We expect some drought as well in the South America because La Niña and so on. But every time the market, they are playing with these criteria, and it's not easy to understand clearly the situation and to predict. So, of course, you have as well the global commodity market with oil and ethanol. Ethanol is mostly produced by sugar cane when it is produced in South America. But in North America, in US, it is the corn which is used to produce ethanol. And the US government has a strong policy to secure a significant part of the gasoline made from ethanol. So it is important to consider that the states, they use more than 30% of their crop for ethanol purpose. So that means they use more or less 120, 130 million tons of corn for ethanol processing. And of course, we have this sanitary crisis possibility. And this year, we are experiencing a significant problem with the COVID-19. And as you know, it has much impacted the market. And when the lockdown did appear in March, so the market went down significantly, and it was very difficult to have any visibility in the market. So, and this situation is still impacting the market because we don't have any visibility onward, and the people, they are buying short instead of long position. And then there is still the Chinese secret, I would say, because this country is very reluctant to release some transparent information concerning the consumption and the stock. So it seems that the stock are reducing at the moment, and we will see how it can impact the situation. So let's have a look now to the figures. Generally speaking, I would say that there is a nice crop on the world scale, because when we consider all cereals, you have three columns. One is last year crop, 1920, and the next one is average over the 5 years time, and the next one is the crop expected for 2021. And you can see that on an overall perspective for the cereals, we expect 2,227,000,000 tons of cereals on the planet. And last year it was 2,181,000,000 tons. And on the 5 years level, it is 2,141,000,000 tons. So we cannot complain about the cereals crop for this year. But the market is not looking at the things like we could think. So for the maize, it's still a nice crop, as already said. And we have a record, and we record plus 39 million tons of corn on the planet this year compared to last year. So the consumption is still growing steadily as well. They are following more or less the production, because we expect 38 million tons plus in terms of source consumption when we produce plus 45 million tons. So it's almost balanced, but the two, the production and the consumption are going in the same direction. So then when we look at the corn, we expect some significant consumption as well for the corn. There are two uses. One is industrial uses, and one is for the animal feeding. So you can see that the figures, they are still on the, I would say, the positive direction, because the consumption is growing for the corn. So the final stock for the corn is a little bit less than last year. We lose 16 million tons. And if we do not consider the Chinese territory, so it would be more or less balanced. So the matter today is what is happening in China. And this is a key key problem to go through, to understand what is the Chinese position and situation in terms of stock and corn needs. Not only the corn, it can be the same for the soybean, but for the corn, it is a serious matter. So the ratio which is important is the stock over consumption, and you can see that we are losing some percentage of for this ratio. Now we are reaching more or less 24%. It is 2% less than last year, but when we look at the 5 years trend, it is 6% less. So this is important, because the market are looking at this criteria very significantly. When we look at the main producer, we can see that the largest one, they are still there. US, for instance, Brazil, and to less extent, Argentina, Ukraine, Russia, and so on. So we observe a significant growth for US and Brazil, but for Argentina, Ukraine, and Russia, it's more or less balanced, a little bit maybe less, because the harvest is still ongoing, and we don't know the final figures, but it seems that in Europe, for instance, the yield will be not as good as we were expecting, especially in Ukraine, Russia, and Romania, as we will see later. Concerning the importer, more than 100 million tons of corn is imported. So from the different country, the biggest importer basically is the EU. We expect 25 million tons imported this year. But these kind of figures, they are under control. We know about these figures, the situation. When it comes to talk about China, it's a different story, because last year, 2 years ago, for instance, they did import 4 million tons. Last year, the estimate was around 7 million tons, and this year we envisage 7 million tons, but it could be more. So, question mark. You know that the oil has to be considered as an important criteria as well, the oil price, because of the ethanol use. And when the oil is very cheap, it is less profitable to produce ethanol to mix with oil. So we know that the U.S. government is encouraging, and has a strong policy to encourage the blend between the ethanol and oil. But so far, when the oil is very competitive, of course, the ethanol refinery, they are closing the factory. And it has happened this year due to the COVID crisis, for instance, many factories have closed down in U.S. So it is reducing the consumption of corn in states, and this corn has to be exported or used for different reasons, for different purposes, and it is impacting, of course, the price of the corn. And you have seen that this year, during the springtime and during summer, the price of the corn was low, despite the wheat was on the higher side, and because there were a lot of offer on the market from states and from Ukraine as well. Concerning Europe, I would say that we have an unstable balance. The situation is not critical, but is not good. So we have to look at the figures. we have a lower production. We lost more or less 6-7 million tons so far. Maybe we may face a lower yield, average yield over Europe, especially when we consider France, for instance. I guess that we are still optimistic in France with 13.5 million metric tons expected to be harvested. Last year it was below 12 million, but it's not sure at the moment that we can secure those 13.5 million tons of corn because the yields are disappointing. So the availability is on the downside, and the consumption is a little bit reducing as well. It is mostly due to the less animal feeding and maybe less export as well. Yes, a little bit less export compared to the last few years. So we try to balance the situation, but on an overall, we have a final stock which is decreasing, and we are losing more or less 4 million tons as a final stock. So the ratio stock over the use is on the downside. So it's 21% when we were using some 28% on a regular basis. So for the next slide, you can see where the corn crop is happening. So the main producer in the EU is Romania, just in front of the French territory. And this year, Romania has observed a significant drop in the yield and in the production due to the drought. And it is more or less the same in Ukraine. Ukraine is not in EU, but it's a next door country to Romania. And they are observing some difficulties for the corn crop this year due to the lack of rain. So it is impacting the situation. In France, we have a little bit higher crop because of more acreage. You know that we lost 10 million tons of wheat this year due to the reduction of acreage because of the rainfall during the seeding period, and then due as well to the drought or overflooding, overraining time to time. It's a very strange situation because when we have rain, we have too much rain, and when we have sun, we have too much sun. So for the plant, it's not easy to grow in such condition. So we lost 10 million tons. So they were placed to plant the corn because some acreage of wheat were not planted. And so the farmer, they decided to seed the corn instead of the wheat. So it has made a larger acreage. But the yield is not so good. So let's see what is happening at the end of the crop. Concerning the French territory, so on this mapping, you have to look at the maize map, which is on the right and down right map. So this situation is just showing you where the corn is in better shape and where the corn is in the, I would say, bad shape. So we can see that on the northwest of France, the corn is growing nicely. We have nice condition and we expect a nice crop. But this area is mostly dedicated to animal feeding and for the silage mainly. So there are some corn, especially in the southwest of Paris area. But generally speaking, this area is mostly dedicated to animal feeding and the silage. But for the rest of the other regions of France, we observe a reduction of the yield this year, and these areas are mainly dedicated to the production of raw corn, the grain. Okay, and the grain is going to animal feeding or food industry anyway. So now, if we look at Euronext, as you can see, the situation has changed significantly within 2 weeks' time, I would say. And in 2 weeks' time, we have reached some highs, not only for the corn. We could have a look to the wheat market. It would be the same because it's very much connected each other. But for the corn, the market pick up by 20 euro within 2 weeks' time. And now the corn is around 190 or more or less, when the wheat is 210. The difference between wheat and corn is 20 euro, but do not forget that 2-3 weeks ago the difference was more than 25 euro. So now the difference is recovering, I would say, because it is cheaper to use the corn for animal feeding than to use the wheat, and the buyer, they are buying corn now for the animal feeding. So, and the market situation, the harvest situation is not so nice. So it is making the market more nervous. So let's have a look now to the synthesis of the situation when we have a look at the bullish elements. So we can see that there is a significant high demand from China. This high demand was not so much predicted, and at least it is a fact. So you know that there was a dispute between US and China. Now I have the feeling that China, they need the food, and they need to rebuild up their stock and to make sure that they have the food. We can say as well that the different buyers, the different countries, they are buying now because they don't want to face any lockdown in case of the COVID-19, I would say, to develop. So in case of if there is any risk to make the shipment and the transportation, it's better to start early to buy and to ship the goods. So it may affect the situation as well. But in any case, China is an important player in terms of cereals market this year. Concerning we have as well a crop a reduction of the crop forecasted in US, Ukraine, France, due to weather issue, the drought, the storm, and so on. So we had some significant damage, and of course it is less corn to harvest. Then when we look at the Euronext or the Chicago Board of Trade, so the maize is on some highs, and it has reached some highest level. Since the corn is trading at more than 4 euro the bushel, so it's very important. And we have a supportive US policy to maintain ethanol intake in oil production, as already said. So despite that, we still have a competitive maize versus the wheat for feed, and the demand on the world scale is steadily increasing, as already said as well. So, and you have to consider that in Europe, the corn is more or less, and the wheat is more or less the cheapest one in the world. So, having said that, we can think that due to the competitiveness of the European wheat, we can expect more demand from on the world scale for the European wheat. So it could lead to some price increase because of the higher demand. Local maize price are calculating nicely as well. Last year it was not the case because we could benefit some nice import from Ukraine, for instance, at cheaper price to feed the animal in France, on the west side of France. But this year, because of the situation in Russia and in Ukraine, we observe that the French corn is competitive. And on an overall level, we still have the funds which are remaining at the purchase of the corn and the cereals, and they enter the speculation. So everything is contributing to have some higher price in the market. Concerning the bearish elements, it's not easy to find a significant one to balance the situation, but maybe within 1 month's time it will be different. At least we need to wait, I would say, early next year to have a better visibility on the acreage, the acreage of the wheat for the crop 21. So according to that, and as well what is happening in terms of weather in the south hemisphere, especially in Argentina or Brazil for the corn harvest, or the wheat harvest in Australia, for instance, we may have some change in the market. Maybe the market will still continue to grow in terms of price. Maybe we could have a more, I would say, relaxing situation, but it's not sure for the time being. So we have high worldwide production level. So as already said, we have reached some highs this year, especially for the corn. So normally we should not be worried about that. We have an important closure of a starch factory in France, in north of France, which was using a lot of quantity of corn. And of course, any stronger COVID-19 measure in France or in Europe may affect the demand, and we have seen that in March this year. So the American market, American maize harvest is well established now. It's more than 60% of the crop is over. So it's a good ratio. Last year it was, or the last 5 years, it was an average level of 43%. So when the corn is stored, it's a good thing. And more than 65% of the French maize is as well harvested versus 30% last year and 49% over the last 5 years. And now the rain is coming back to Russia and Ukraine, so it will be helping the wheat seeding, because so far the plantation of the wheat has been done in a very dry condition. So it was giving a lot of worried about the future of the wheat crop. But now, because of the rain coming up, so we can expect some more safe situation in that area for the wheat crop. Just a few words about our corn identity preserve organization at Limagrain Ingredients. Of course, we buy some corn, but we buy the corn in a very specific organization, and we have our own identity preserve organization. We ask our farmer to produce suitable corn for the maize milling application, and we look for a very specific corn, which is namely the Dent Flint maize. It's durum endosperm, which is helping the milling process. So we are not at all interested in the Dent corn, which is a floury corn, and this corn is more dedicated to the starch industry. And we use the Dent Flint corn to make the grits, the flaking grits, the semolina, and the flour. So this corn is becoming less and less available in the market, because for the farmer, the Dent corn is much more productive than the Dent Flint corn. So the gap in terms of yield in the fields is becoming bigger, larger and larger between the quantity a farmer can expect from the Dent genetic versus the Dent Flint genetic. So it can be a serious problem to feed the maize milling industry all over Europe. So we have this identity preserve organization. And this is a good thing for us, because we can secure the quality, and we expect to secure as well the quantity, because we have our local farmer, which are around the mill, and it's a very sustainable organization. So having said that, we have as well organic offer. We have a partnership with a company for a long time, and where we ask them to produce some quantity of organic corn, and which giving us the possibility to offer some organic product as well. And of course, we have as well baby food grade quality with standard corn, but baby food grade, and it's a very long lasting experience for baby food industry. Now I have finished my presentation, and I am very happy to welcome your question. So do not hesitate to send me your question so that I can give you the answer right now.
Thanks a lot, Claude. We have a first question about the quality of the maize this year. Do you have some information about that?
So the quality of the corn, we have a main focus. Okay, we have a main focus on the sanitary aspect with the mycotoxin. Mycotoxin, as you know, is an important issue for the corn, because the corn is harvested lately in October, when it is becoming to be rainy and a little bit cold weather. So in that condition, the mycotoxin can develop very fast, especially after the 15th of October. So this year, we have started the harvest early September, and now we are almost terminating the harvest. So far, we have recorded very good data concerning the mycotoxin level. So we are at a very low level because the harvest has been done on the early time. And as well, we use some suitable corn variety because to allow us to harvest the corn early instead of keeping the corn waiting in the fields. So it's a good year, but be careful. The regulation is becoming, I would say, more and more straight. And there is a big discussion at the European level at the moment concerning the maximum residues of mycotoxin in the corn, especially for the dawn. So it's a big fight with the EU organization, the DG Santé, and our organization, Euromaïsier, is trying to defend the position to keep on going with the level of 1,750 ppb per for the corn. So, but once again, it is under discussion, and we have to put our pressure on that. And we expect to get the help as well of the different users, the snack user and the breakfast cereals user and so on, to support the fact that it will be very difficult to reduce this kind of level of mycotoxin, because afterward, if we go lower than today, it will be we will be facing serious difficulties some years when we are having some mycotoxin.
Thank you, Claude. We have a second question. Which type of maize is used for baby food flours?
So basically, we use the same quality corn as for the breakfast cereals and the snacks product, etc. The question is that we qualify the corn. We make a lot of analyses, not only for the mycotoxin. For the mycotoxin, we make it for all the corn, but we have some additional analyses, especially for the pesticide residue. So we qualify some beans. Hopefully, we have we store around 800-1,000 tons per silo per beans. So it is helping us when we want to check the quality of one beans to use it as baby food grade. And then for the baby food, we take only the flour part of the kernel to supply the baby food industry. And most of the time, the qualification of the bean is made in accordance with the customer. So we agreed on the quality of a bean. But do not forget that the corn is very less demanding in terms of pesticide use. There is only the herbicide at the beginning of the seeding. And then, time to time, there is insecticide which can be used on the flower of the corn to protect it from the caterpillar. But there are as well some natural fight, natural preservation. We introduce some insect to destroy the caterpillar. So it's natural way to protect the plant. And so having said that, we can say that the corn is only using pesticide for the herbicides, that's it. So it's at the end, it is a very low pesticide residue in the corn.
Thank you. We have another question for maize flours. Is the functionality the same as last year, specifically flour composition and viscosity?
Okay, so we have a special look at this criteria because it can affect the process of our customer. And we check, we monitor this criteria. The most important first is to have a consistent genetic. So we spend money to develop our own genetic. And this genetic is made according to the customer need. So the RVA, the level of viscosity we need is a criteria that we can use to screen the new variety. So in that respect, we have a very consistent figures concerning the viscosity level. But we can observe time to time, according to the weather, for instance, it can affect the viscosity. But generally speaking, I would say that this is something which is under control. And this year we have observed some change, but not important one, and it is under control.
And we can take a last question before ending this webinar session. Is there any significant change in the non-GMO market for corn?
Today, I would say it's not a question for us, non-GMO or GMO. The consumer, they don't want any GMO product. So we are organized to supply the market with non-GMO product. So this is, I would say, a European position, including France, and we are organized to deliver non-GMO product, and today it's not a discussion.
Okay, thanks a lot, Claude.
My pleasure.
Thanks to all of you for attending to this webinar, and we will see you the next time. Thank you.
Thank
Goodbye.
You.